A searing, white-hot flash of light burst over the horizon, followed by a deafening roar of a colossal explosion, drowning out the wail of warning sirens. Many had been instantly blinded by looking directly at the light. Others were incinerated on the spot from being too close to the blast. Then there were those lucky enough to avoid both, but who still got caught in the shockwaves, traveling at supersonic speeds, destroying anything in its path. Anyone at a safe enough distance saw the skyline was now dominated by a dark, looming shape of a mushroom cloud, and the sight filled them with inescapable dread at what was coming next. It had finally happened. The first bomb had been dropped, and more were on the way. A bombardment of radioactive hellfire raining down across the world. Nuclear war had broken out, a war without any hope for survival. Yet, there was but one left. The Black Hills mountain range in South Dakota had once been home to a former army base that was snapped up by a real estate company called Vivos. But they hadn't been apartments or condominiums. Their dealings were in state-of-the-art, catastrophe-ready doomsday bunkers so people could survive the end of days at affordable prices. Mason had never been a doomsday prepper, one of those people who seemed a little too excited about the prospect of the world ending, stockpiling as many guns and cans of soup as they could cram into their homemade several thousand-dollar panic rooms. But even though he wasn't crazy, Mason had always said there was never too high a price to pay for a peace of mind, even if 55 grand wasn't exactly cheap. You see, Mason might not have considered himself to be paranoid, but he was certainly aware. He paid attention to the world around him, noticed the mounting international tensions and worrying signs on the news. And so when he heard that a company was selling nuclear bunkers, it seemed to be a worthwhile investment. After all, if the world didn't end, he could always refurbish it into an escape room or a novelty Airbnb. Little did he expect he actually would get to use it. Whereas most contingency plans for nuclear Armageddon were focused on ensuring the survival of the wealthy and powerful, Mason had fallen into a very small niche of people who were aware the world was edging closer to destruction and who could also afford to be prepared for the outcome. Sure enough, when the nukes started to fly left, right, and center, that preparation had paid off. It wasn't clear who had fired the first shot, but what was clear, at least to those paying attention like Mason, was that the bombs had hit other states first. Being at a distance from a raging fireball caused by an atomic explosion and far out of the range of the electromagnetic pulse frying power grids and electronic devices brought him a few precious moments of escape time. But it wouldn't be long before the nuclear barrage hit South Dakota as well. Racing as fast as his car could take him, Mason sped from his home in nearby Hill City to the mountains, not stopping until he was securely locked inside his bunker. Breathing a sigh of relief, he was grateful to have made it to safety. And from the sounds of the carnage unfolding above, he'd made it not a moment too soon. Underground, he was protected from the shockwaves, extreme heat and radiation released by any nuclear bomb that dropped. But of course, it was hard to be happy about the whole situation. Hearing the world ending right above your head will certainly make any sense of relief very fleeting. Once the existential dread of knowing everything he knew and loved was being reduced to ash, and wondering if he was the last man on Earth, had eventually subsided, Mason was left with an equally horrifying question. What now? Fortunately, Mason's bunker wasn't just an empty, unfurnished underground room. It had been outfitted for at least a year's worth of minimal autonomous operation, removing any need for him to venture out into the scorched, irradiated surface of the world. The initial wave from each nuclear explosion was bad enough, but the second wave from the fallout was arguably worse. Radioactive particles and debris kicked up into the air by the sheer force of each blast, only to gradually come raining or falling back down to Earth, hence the name. Exposure to nuclear fallout carried by winds could cause radiation sickness, cancer, and eventually death by contaminating the breathable air along with irradiating any food or water left behind. Being trapped underground made it hard for Mason not to feel isolated. Even though he owned one of the smaller Black Hills bunkers, it had been designed and furnished to house more than just one person. He found himself using the extra four twin bedrooms almost as vacation bedrooms when he got sick of sleeping in his double room, just to alleviate the boredom. The first year in the bunker seemed to pass at a slow crawl, but it wasn't long afterward that things started breaking down. His water filtration system had malfunctioned, and none of the tools or spare parts he stored in the bunker were suitable. He had tried every last conceivable option, anything to avoid stepping outside, even as a last resort. But running out of viable solutions and becoming more and more dehydrated, it was beginning to look like he'd have to leave the safety of his bunker after all. Outside, waiting for him, were the horrors of a nuclear winter. Thanks to the widespread scale of the nuclear war on the surface and the sheer number of atom bombs detonated, this had triggered a climatic event once only thought to be purely theoretical. It goes without saying that the damage caused by a nuclear bomb when it directly hits a target and detonates is nothing short of devastating. The immediate heat from the blast is enough to vaporize human beings until little more than a scorched silhouette remains on the ground or nearby walls. The shockwave from the blast can also damage, if not entirely demolish, most standing structures too, meaning not even buildings stand a chance of staying standing if they're too close. But what also occurs when a nuclear device detonates is that massive amounts of dust and debris are thrown up into the air. A nuclear winter occurs when the explosions of several nuclear weapons cause these large quantities of dust and debris, including the aforementioned nuclear fallout, to float up into the atmosphere. This mass of debris, as well as the residual smoke from the blasts, would then theoretically form a barrier thick enough to block out the sun. This would prevent a great deal of the sun's light, and more importantly heat, from reaching the surface. With the sun's rays blocked by a thick fog of fallout and atmospheric debris, the temperatures across the planet would begin to drop rapidly, to around 50 to just under 70 degrees Fahrenheit. This is exactly what happened while Mason had been hiding in the safety of his bunker. Previous scientific theories had hypothesized that the emissions generated by nuclear fireballs would completely destroy the ozone layer surrounding the Earth. However, by the 1980s, those theories had largely been discredited, and more plausible effects of nuclear war on the climate started to be considered. But Mason had assumed that above ground things would be scorching hot thanks to all the heat from the explosions, but in reality, the opposite was true. Still, he knew it was suicide to step outside unprotected, even if he was in for a surprise as to just how cold it was beyond the safety of his bunker. Preparation for venturing outside after a nuclear war was not something Mason could ever be too cautious about. Being underprepared would mean exposure to nuclear fallout, so he started by taking some potassium iodine tablets. These would flood his body with safe iodine, blocking any radioactive iodine present in nuclear fallout from being absorbed into his body and poisoning him. With the dose he'd taken, it would keep Mason safe for about 24 hours. He had a reliable gas mask on hand as well, military-grade CM7M full face one that he quickly put on, securing it tightly. Of course, the gas mask itself was useless without a filter, which he screwed into the mask to prevent him breathing in any radioactive iodine. Then he slipped into a protective hazmat suit and gloves, using chemical-resistant tape to seal any gaps between the gloves and his sleeves, and the suit's legs and his boots, making sure he was as protected as it was possible for him to be. Gathering up a survival kit he'd been gathering in a bug-out bag, consisting of useful items like a rope, flashlight, personal radio, a basic first aid kit, and a Geiger counter, Mason was ready at last to take his first nervous steps beyond his bunker and out into the world ravaged by nuclear winter. Stepping outside, the low temperature was the first shock to Mason's system. It was certainly a far cry from the insulated warmth inside his bunker. The hazmat suit over his clothes protected him somewhat, and luckily he'd sealed it well enough to keep much of his own body heat trapped, but that wouldn't entirely negate the effects of the nuclear winter's cold. In the area of South Dakota near the Black Hills, temperatures already fluctuated considerably depending on the time of year. On average, it could reach highs of 75 degrees Fahrenheit in the summer and drop all the way to the lower 30s at the start or tail end of the year. With just that disparity in the space of a few months, the time of year and regular temperature would be a crucial factor in how severe the effects of a nuclear winter would be. And those are the highs, too. In colder areas, if the temperature is already lower, then that number is only going to go down thanks to the lack of heat from the sun. Mason had found himself in what theorists had classed as a nominal nuclear winter. In the case of a minimal one, a small nuclear attack would have no effect on the environment. While a marginal scenario would still see lower temperatures, even a nominal nuclear winter was still thought to be on the lower end of the scale in terms of the damage and impact a full-scale nuclear war would have on the climate, and would likely occur after the detonation of between 6,000 and 12,000 nuclear weapons. The fluctuating streak of bad to good luck that Mason was experiencing seemed to be continuing, since he'd exited his bunker with too few layers to keep himself warm enough, but he'd also left on a day in April. The average lowest temperature in the area would have normally been around 48 degrees, but now, with the huge clouds of ash and radioactive debris acting as an umbrella blocking out the sunlight, it was significantly colder. In fact, in the year since the bombs had first fallen, nuclear winter had made the temperatures consistently lower all across South Dakota, as well as the world. If he'd been outside on a May day before the bombs had dropped, the lowest average temperature would be around 21 degrees. With a nuclear winter in effect, it was now barely reaching 3 Fahrenheit, something that would cause Mason far more problems than just feeling a little cold. Thanks to the thick blanket of radioactive dust in the atmosphere, The sky had gone dark. Little to no sunlight reaching the surface of the Earth meant visibility was poor, and while Mason didn't quite need to rely on his flashlight in order to get around, it was far darker than an overcast day. Even at noon, when the sun had reached its highest point in the sky, the sunlight was only about a third of what it would have been on a normal day for that time of year, and this lower level of light wasn't seasonal, it persisted all year long. As much as the sun would have made it easier to see, Mason didn't find himself wishing it would return. Thanks to the number of nuclear weapons exploding, the air around them would have been subjected to intense heat, followed by rapid cooling. These were the perfect conditions for nitrogen oxides to form. Such high levels of nitrogen oxides, coupled with the heat being absorbed by the dark layer of soot in the atmosphere, would have destroyed around 70% of the ozone layer. So, when the smoke of the nuclear winter eventually cleared, there would be an increased amount of ultraviolet radiation reaching the surface, emitted by the sun. This could cause damage to people and animals alike, affecting their eyes and also increase their likelihood of developing skin cancer, in addition to outright killing a lot of the animal and plant life, if there was any left at that point. Braving the icy temperatures only protected by the hazmat suit and layers of clothes he had on underneath, Mason headed off in search of other bunkers. There were 557 available when he bought his, so Mason figured he at least wouldn't have to venture much further than the former Black Hills Army base. His main objective was to find enough tools or replacement parts to repair his water filtration system, but he had decided it was worth attempting to restock on supplies. He knew to avoid anything that wasn't packaged. Any food or water that had been exposed to the outside elements was likely riddled with radioactive fallout and would at best require a lot of washing before even coming close to preparing and eating. So, he thought it was best to stick to any canned or dried food he happened across, just as long as it was in sealed packaging. When it came to water, he obviously couldn't trust any outdoor sources. Now they'd be all irradiated. But he hadn't exactly been downing tall glasses of parasite and bacteria-riddled river water even before the war, so avoiding rivers and lakes came instinctively. The same could be said for any crops that had been growing nearby at the time of the bombs dropping. The dimming of the sun also meant that the plants couldn't photosynthesize properly. That was evident to Mason just by looking at what few trees had been near the Black Hills bunkers. They were all dead, and those that were still standing were scorched by the blaze. Walking around in the wake of the war was unnerving. Every tick of the Geiger counter put Mason on edge, causing him to take sharp, nervous breaths. Then hearing his own breathing contained by his mask made him think about everything he could potentially be breathing in if his filter stopped working. It wasn't just radioactive fallout contaminating the air, but pollutants of all sorts. While the temperature below the smoke and dust was extremely cold, above it was much hotter, thanks to the sunlight being absorbed by the fallout in the atmosphere. This temperature inversion helped keep any of the byproducts of fires closer to the level people breathe at, and a lot of fires had occurred when the bombs had incinerated large swaths of the planet, meaning that dioxins, sulfurous gases, and other pollutants were not only prevented from fully rising upward into the atmosphere, but were dense and toxic to anyone unfortunate enough to breathe them in. Mason prayed he wouldn't find out just how toxic the air was, as long as he kept his mask on and didn't remove his filter. Arriving at one of the other bunkers, Mason was met with a heavy sealed door. Trying in vain to get it to budge, he decided it was probably pointless in knocking. After all, his underground neighbor probably wasn't expecting any social calls now that civilization had collapsed. Searching further, Mason found another of the bunkers a short walk away. Judging by the open door, this one was unoccupied. He tried not to think about whether or not it had been that way because it was still waiting to be sold when the bombs dropped, or if it had been opened after by someone forcing their way in. Stepping into the compromised bunker, Mason looked around, thoroughly checking some of the nearest bedrooms for any signs of life. Nobody in. Strangely, any sense of comfort that provided him was fleeting, disappearing the moment he saw that the interior of the bunker had been ransacked. Searching for supplies and other useful resources was hardly going to be an easy task, even if someone hadn't already beaten him to it. Since the door to this bunker had been wide open, there was a high chance much of the radiation from outside had come flooding inside the moment the bunker had been exposed to the toxic elements. Even here, Mason had to keep his suit on. And while he was grateful for the slight increase in temperature that came from being inside, his warmer body temperature caused the lenses of his gas mask to get foggy. That was the least of his problems, though. It didn't seem like there was anything that useful down here. Navigating was easy enough, at least. The layout of the bunker was almost identical to his, so finding his way around came naturally. After all, apart from the mess, it was just like the space he'd spent the last year of his life trapped in. As Mason searched throughout the raided supply closets, sifting through the mess that had been left behind, his hope for finding anything that could help him dwindled. Every time he reached for what looked at a distance to be an unopened can of food, he would lift it to feel its empty weight. As he threw each one back to the floor, his heart sank further. Mason was hardly the last man alive, after all. Those who hadn't been killed or blinded by the blasts would have suffered severe burns to their skin if they'd been anywhere near the blast radius, and somehow managed to avoid the devastation of the initial shockwave. There were many pockets of survivors located all over the globe. In some countries with good civil defense systems in place, like Switzerland or Finland, there was already an extensive network of blast shelters and fallout shelters. The latter even had enough shelters to house its entire urban population. Both Australia and New Zealand had a fairly low population density, with these two countries also having massive food reserves stored away out of reach of fallout from the Northern Hemisphere. And all over in Iceland, they hardly had to worry about food. Thanks to their autonomous food production systems, they could continue to meet the demand of their survivors. Elsewhere, though, the struggle for acquiring resources had been expectedly competitive among the few who had managed to survive by regularly venturing on the surface and braving the nuclear winter's Arctic temperatures, although not many of them survived for long. With production of food and other essentials all but shut down completely, that meant there were limited resources available to those who needed them, and mass starvation had already claimed many lives. It didn't just go for food, either. Electricity was scarce, if not completely unavailable. Those like Mason who had generators providing their bunkers were lucky, and needed fuel to keep those generators working. His search for food proving quite literally fruitless, Mason started to look for other things he could use. Spare water filters, tools, literally anything that could improve the state of his bunker. There was nothing. Whoever had beaten him to the punch had cleared the place out top to bottom and destroyed anything of use. He started to wonder if the bunker had been empty and just gotten obliterated in a nuclear blast, and sometime after someone had come and cleared out anything left that was still useful. Now walking back out into the cold of the nuclear winter outside, Mason was faced with a choice. He still needed to fix his filtration system, otherwise he'd die a slow, painful death via dehydration. The problem was, the next bunker was a longer walk away, and he was already freezing. His body temperature was plummeting, so he could either race back to his own bunker, decontaminate himself and his hazmat suit, then try again another day, or he could try to reach the next nearest bunker, which could easily be in the same state as the one he just left. But it might have what he needed. Mason made the mistake of continuing his search. Despite the protection against fallout offered by his suit and the iodine pills he'd taken earlier, the one thing neither of them could prevent was long exposure to cold temperatures caused by nuclear winter. His core body temperature, which usually hovered around 98 degrees, would begin falling thanks to the freezing temperatures outside his suit. Once the body dips to 95 degrees Fahrenheit, hypothermia occurs, aided by the sweat that had accumulated thanks to the body heat trapped inside his hazmat suit. As his body temperature dropped, his vital organs began to fail until Mason couldn't breathe properly. Collapsing as he desperately tried to turn back to his bunker, he eventually died. It wasn't the radiation or even the nuclear bombs themselves that got him in the end. It was merely the cold of the nuclear winter. Now check out why nuclear Armageddon is unstoppable, or watch this instead.